Ladies and gentlemen, we now invite you all to be seated.
Our Father, who art in heaven, at the commencement of this special occasion, we pause before thee to acknowledge thy goodness to us and the liberties and the beauties that have just been mentioned and sung for us. We're deeply grateful, our Father, for the special event that brings us together this day, for the inauguration of President Orville D. Carnahan as the fifth president of this, the Utah Technical College. And Father, we thank thee for those who were the founders of this great institution, who had the foresight and the vision to be able to see that which has been built in this part of this valley as a crossroads for those who seek learning, understanding, preparation and wisdom, that they might better qualify themselves to become successful individuals in life. We're grateful, our Father, for those students who have found their footsteps brought to the doorsteps of this fine campus. We ask a special blessing to be upon those who are registered here at this time, that they might catch the vision and the spirit of their new president and be able to look forward with courage and challenge and daring to prepare themselves for those responsibilities that are theirs. We're deeply grateful, our Father, for the faculty and its devotion and willingness to share, that the faculty members might be receptive to the opportunities that are theirs. We pray a special blessing to be with them. And Father, we're mindful this day of President Carnahan and his family. Look down upon him and guide him. Help him to formulate those policies and plans now that will take this institution to new heights. Help him to surround himself with wisdom and with inspiration from not only thee, but those who are called to administer to the needs of this campus. We humbly pray that those who are here might do more than seek learning. They might gain knowledge. That they might do more than to prepare for a vocation. That they might prepare for life. That they might do more than just hear, but listen. That they might do more than see, but observe. That they might do more than live. That they might grow and develop and magnify the blessings that are theirs. Now bless those this hour who will participate on this program, that they might be inspired by thee, that that which is said and done might be of an inspirational nature to all who are present. And bless us that we might always unite together in such causes as this day, to better strengthen the facilities, the opportunities, and the challenges that are a part of our life. All of which we humbly pray in the name of thy beloved Son, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Now, if I can get the lump out of my throat, we're okay. I want to welcome you all here today and to tell you how I personally am grateful for this opportunity to be part of this ceremony and the privilege I consider it to be part of this fine institution. It falls to me to introduce folks who are here today. Before I do, I'd like to thank Craig Stevenson and Margita Gerber for that beautiful music. Certainly set a beautiful stage for us. The governor's missed his chance, you realize. He was supposed to be here and come in ahead of me, but I got to walk in first. He's coming later. We just got word that he's on his way over from Wendover and very anxious to be here, but we'll forgive him if he's a little late. And so if you see a little disruption in the program, let's all be understanding, because we love him. Aside from the governor who's coming, we have some impressive, beautiful people here today, including you. We have with us the Commissioner of Higher Education for the state of Utah, Dr. Arvo Van Alstyne. We're going to hear from some of these folks later, of course. Chairman of the Utah State Board of Regents, Kim Gardner. Representing the Utah State for Vocational Education, Dr. Ross Denham. He's a big guy. I shook hands with him. I seem to feel intimidated by people when they're so huge, but boy, they sure stand tall and love them. Utah Technical College Emeritus, Jay Nelson, an old friend that we love. He was also representing today the U.S. Secretary of Education, Dr. Terrell Bell. Dr. Bell asked if Jay would represent him at this meeting, and he doesn't show on the program, and so he will speak probably first, because it doesn't look like the governor will be here in time to start out our talk session. On the stand also are other members of the Utah State Board of Regents. They're the guys with the funny round hats that look like, you know. In fact, Kim threw me his hat. I don't know what he thought it was for. They're really very nice looking. I'm a little jealous, in fact. Including also on the stage today are former presidents of the college, including Howard Gunderson, the institution's first president, Jim Snurl, acting president immediately prior to Dr. Carnahan's joining us. We've loved Jim also, and he's worked with us. Pleased also to have Cal Corbridge, president of the Associated Students of Utah Technical College. He's a good-looking kid with a beard. And Jerry Fulmer, one of our Utah Tech administrators, who at this time, at one time or the other, in the school, has been a student, an alumnus, a classified staff employee, instructor, and staff person. So we've got some impressive people. And finally on the platform is Reverend Monsignor Jerome C. Stoffel of the Catholic Diocese of Salt Lake, who will offer the benediction at the conclusion of this convocation. So we've got some lovely people here, and we're glad that you can see them all. Very important person and persons to President Carnahan, of course, are Mrs. Carnahan and her family. Would you please stand, by the way? Mrs. Carnahan and family, the whole gang. Aside from all the chatter about family relationships, we really know who's in charge and who's important. And wives do have to be special people to support those of us who are involved in these kinds of efforts, and we're appreciative of Mrs. Carnahan. Because of the limited space, we've placed the dignitaries, many dignitaries in the audience. You're all dignitaries, but let me identify who's in there with you. And you can appreciate them. Include presidents and representatives from each of the 9 institutions belonging to the Utah system of higher education, as well as Brigham Young and Westminster College representing the private institutions. Would you folks raise your hands who fit in that category, by the way? Let us all share with who we got. Additionally, we have directors of each of the vocational centers in the state and the skills centers also. And in addition to our own faculty and the staff at the college here present, we have dignitaries from the state and local governments, including David Wilkinson, the Attorney General, and David, Lieutenant Governor Monson, a member of the Board of Regents. In fact, as Brian was preparing these notes for me, because he knew I'd flub without him, he said, parenthetically, and that's Brian, you know, it's got to be some fancy word like that. Since the governor is here, only he isn't here yet, Brian. A little while, we can make this work. Where is he? Oh, there. You know, you've heard about these late arrivals, haven't you? Yeah? It's okay, Governor. Anyway, parenthetically, since the governor is here and Lieutenant Governor David Monson, a member of the Board of Regents, there could be a Board Examiners meeting going on the side. But we won't do that today, okay? We're glad you're here, Governor. If you came from Flint, you flew. Did you parachute or? We're also pleased that Mayor Henry Price and Commissioner Wagstaff of West Valley City are in the audience, and that's important. We're in that area of our community, and we need their support and appreciate it so much. We have in the audience also several members of the State Board for Vocational Education, as well as various respective staff members from both State Office of Education and Utah Higher System of Education. And I think I indicated, I hope I did, that we have members of the Institutional Council who are my co-workers that I love so much with us today too. Following the convocation today, there will be an informal buffet and reception in the North Cafeteria of the College Center. And you may want to come and visit with President Carnahan on that occasion and give him your congratulations. And that will commence about 20 minutes after we've concluded these ceremonies. So thank you for your patience. We appreciate so much your being here. And again, I'll say speech 23, and then you all nod your heads, and you know, and then I've given my speech. We've got some wonderful people to talk to you today, and we're going to proceed as the program outlines with no further clues or cues. So I think we'll start with Governor Mathis, and Governor Mathis.
Thank you. Thank you very much. I'm very pleased to be here. I apologize for my late arrival. I had the opportunity not too long ago to involve myself in a salutation to Orville Carnahan, where I wished him well in Cedar City, the community where I was an instructor and where I was raised. And now the second opportunity to salute him and his wife in embarking on this new experience. We're growing so rapidly in this state, in terms of our population, that at the rate we are now going, by 1990, we will be importing about 50% of the vocational jobs in the state of Utah. Unless we put into motion in the decade of the 80s the processes and the tools and the resources for those positions to be filled by the ever-burgeoning population from within our state itself. We have also been discovered all over the land, wherever I travel. I find that people are anxious to learn more about and move into and become a part of what happens here in the state of Utah. It is a very, very special place. And the commitment which its citizens have made to make it a worthy place to continue to live and to raise our families requires great public commitment. There are so many areas where all of us need to put our best foot forward to manage the future of our state. One essential component among those is to provide opportunity and availability and ultimately employment for those who come from our families and go through our school systems and who wish to have the state of Utah the place in which to live and earn a decent living. And it is up to our vocational and technical training people, this institution and others similar to it, to help us provide that opportunity. I would like to think that by 1985 that we will have in place the mechanisms by which the trend I have mentioned is totally reversed, so that when the end of the decade arrives, our educational component in all of its facets will be in place, allowing Utah residents to be trained in Utah for Utah jobs. Now that is the direction I give to you, President Carnahan, and I know that you will carry out that successfully, single-handedly, between now and that day. I've had the opportunity on many occasions to meet with President Carnahan, and I'm very, very pleased that the Board of Regents and the Institutional Council have selected him to be the president of this great institution. He comes along at a very critical and important time, but I know from my personal knowledge he is capable and worthy of this position. And as governor of the state, I'm delighted to be here to offer my support and to wish you well. Thank you. Governor Ampton, Governor Matheson, I am to take the liberty of telling you about that incident. At the old laundry building 30 years ago, Governor Ampton came to make an introduction to a distinguished group, somewhat like we have here today. And his successor had been, I think, Governor Clyde. And I made the faux pas of introducing him as Governor Clyde. Governor, it's been a pleasure to work with you on your Executive Reorganization Committee. Mr. Chairman, distinguished guests, and ladies and gentlemen, one of the long-range objectives of Dr. Arvil Carnahan has been to become the president of Utah Technical College here in Salt Lake City. Approximately 14 years ago, Dr. Carnahan came into my office shortly after we had occupied this campus. And he asked me a multitude of questions
He was very inquisitive about how long I intended to remain as president of the institution. And so I strongly suspected that he wanted my job. Well, his objective became a reality on August 1 of this year. Today, I have been asked to assume the responsibility of a dual role. First, it's my pleasure today to represent the four former presidents of Utah Technical College at Salt Lake. Three of the four chiefs are in attendance today. Mr. Howard B. Gunderson, who started the institution back in 1948. Howard, please stand. And James R. Schnurl, who assumed the reins following the resignation of Dr. Dale S. Kogel, and then myself, who served as president of the college for 28 years. And it's great to be home again. On behalf of all of us, Dr. Carnahan, we pledge our support, our cooperation, and we assure you that we'll do all in our power to perpetuate the growth and development of this great vocational technical college. My second responsibility today, let me say that it is a signal honor for me to represent the Secretary of Education of these United States of America at the ceremonies today. Secretary Terrell H. Bell was intended to be present at the inaugural today, but he was unavoidably detained in Washington. Secretary Bell has played a very significant role in the development of this college during the years that he served as State Superintendent of Public Instruction, and then again later while he served as Commissioner of Higher Education in the great state of Utah. The Secretary sends his greetings to each of you and his sincere congratulations to President Carnahan and his family. Secretary Bell has worked closely with President Carnahan when President Carnahan served as Associate Commissioner for the State Board of Regents. And then he later worked with Dr. Carnahan as Dr. Carnahan became President of Southern Utah State College at Cedar City. The Secretary pledges his support to sustain and assist the President and the College in the years ahead. Our congratulations to you and sincere best wishes.
President Carnahan, honored guests, students, faculty, and friends of Utah Technical College. It's a great opportunity to represent the students and to participate in the inauguration of Dr. Carnahan, the new president of Utah Technical College. Utah is in an era of considerable growth in business, in industry, in technology, as well as in population. And with that development comes the growth of Utah Technical College and its role in the community. President, you have come aboard and taken a great responsibility. And throughout our discussions, I have felt that you have expressed great concern for meeting the needs of the students, as well as those of the college and the community. The associated students recognize the leadership characteristics that you possess and the dedication you demonstrate in striving towards the goals and objectives that are set for this institution. We are glad to be a part of this college and we support you in your efforts. We hope that in the future that the lines of the communication between the president and the students will remain the same as we have enjoyed with you to this point. Once again, may I reiterate our support and our confidence in your leadership and extend sincere congratulations and best wishes on this, your inauguration day.
President Carnahan, honored guests and friends, I indeed have a rare opportunity of representing many dedicated, sincere, and loyal employees. Mine has been the privilege of attending school here and seeing a change of my own self-worth. Later, working with the custodial staff, I met many of you and came to feel of your commitment and pride. After one quarter, I joined the teaching faculty, and there, for the next 10 years, I witnessed the many hours of service, teaching, training, and counseling with the students. 3 years ago, I joined the college administration. Here, too, was loyalty and dedication to the college and its students. Many times, I've seen the college leaders arrive early, leave late, and even spend their day off trying to keep the college running smoothly. Most of us derive our pleasure from seeing the success of our students. Recently, I had the opportunity of running into a former physics student of mine. Gilbert Martinez told me that he was now an attorney, and I was thrilled for his success. I doubt that Gilbert ever thoroughly grasped the relationship between light and the metastable states of the atom. But somehow, someone here helped Gilbert to grasp his real self-worth. It is Gilbert and the many, many others like him whom we have helped to find happy and productive lives. They are the reason that we have made our commitment to Utah Tech. President Carnahan, in the vocational and two-year college movement, well qualifies you for your position. Many of us have personally known you and have witnessed your enthusiasm, dedication, determination, and your leadership skills. As you reflect upon our performance, remember, the true measure is not where one serves, but rather how well one serves. May we each truly demonstrate our commitment to you and to our college by the quality of service we render. President Carnahan, it is my privilege as the representative for the employees of Utah Technical College to proclaim our acceptance of you as our new president. We offer to you our loyalty and support. We offer it unrestrained and without hesitation. We are excited with the promise of the future. We look to you for leadership and guidance.
Our chairman, Mrs. Lila Bjorklund, is not able to be with us today. She's out of the country and asked if I would represent the board, which I am happy to do. We as a state board for vocational education are very, very interested in the furtherance of vocational education in the state, in all of the school districts of the state, in this institution and like institutions in the, that are now training our people for employment. For 64 years, the elected members of the State Board of Vocational Education have been responsible for vocational training in the state of Utah. Because vocational education is an integral part of the total education program, we are vitally interested in this institution and very concerned that the purpose for which it was founded will continue to expand to meet the ever-growing employment needs of industry and business. Those who attend classes here can be very proud of this college and the training that they can receive. For the competent staff that have been mentioned, who serve here and have served here in times past, it was in 1959 that the State Board for Vocational Education first approached the legislature, and at that time, some $200,000 was appropriated to purchase this site. The 80 acres contained in the campus are well located and meeting the needs, and these beautiful buildings that have been provided by the legislature and other means are now serving well. President Carnahan, we wish you well as you begin your service as president of this important institution. My wife and me had the privilege today of having lunch and sitting across the table from this great man, President Carnahan, and his lovely wife. During the lunch, he told us of some of his background and qualifications and his genuine interest in vocational education. How proud I was to hear him express himself so well, and the intent of his heart is to be dedicated to carrying on the great traditions of this school and to improving upon them. So President Carnahan, representing the constitutional body charged with the general control and supervision of the public school system at all levels, we give you our full support as you officially assume the presidency of the Utah Technical College of Salt Lake.
President Carnahan, distinguished guests and friends of Utah Technical College at Salt Lake. On occasions such as this, we in the Western world tend to pause and reflect upon the more significant meanings of what we're doing. This is one of those occasions, and I personally believe it to be worthwhile for that reason. It gives us pause to think about the ultimate objectives of an institution of this sort, and to think about where our programs lead us in terms of overall missions and goals, rather than in terms of the day-to-day crises that administrators, the teachers, and staff have to meet. President Carnahan, you, I think, are well qualified to serve in this capacity because you have those three basic qualities which will lead you on to success. First of those is the proper attitude. Someone has said that your attitude determines your altitude. I recall one time a few years ago traveling in France with my family. We visited the little manufacturing town of Amiens. There's a story there that back in the Middle Ages, about the year 1300, someone walking through Amiens on dirty and muddy streets saw an individual engaged in laying stone upon stone, along with some companions, and went up and asked them what they were doing. And one of them said, in effect, "Can't you see? I'm laying bricks." He asked the second one, "And what are you doing?" He said, "I am supporting my family with honest toil and work." He went to the third one and asked, "What are you doing?" And he replied, "I am building a cathedral to the greater glory of Almighty God." And what emerged on that site then was one of the great glories of the Renaissance, Amiens Cathedral, which has the greatest clear space from floor to the top of the transept of any ecclesiastical building that has ever graced the floor of this earth, 420 feet of clear space, a magnificent monument to someone and his companions who did have the vision, who had the right attitude. I think, President Carnahan, you have that attitude because I've had many conversations with you and I'm aware of your commitment to building people. You may be building buildings here on this campus. You may be constructing programs that will be beneficial, but in the long run, you'll be building people, people like Gilbert Martinez, of whom we've heard. The second of the great qualities that are necessary to succeed in this position is the quality of commitment or dedication. And I have had many occasions to see Orville Carnahan working in his capacity both as an Associate Commissioner of Higher Education, as President of Southern Utah State College, and have had many conversations with him, and I understand and appreciate and admire and respect his great dedication to the cause of vocational technical education, but an education that is also well-rounded and which builds the qualities for good citizenship and for a happy life for those who undertake that course for their life's career. You have that quality as well. And finally, you need the quality of competence, understanding of what you are about. This is the product of years of experience,
of years of study and of a great deal of hard work and effort on your part, and I'm completely satisfied that you have that quality as well. And so on behalf of the State Board of Regents, on behalf of the staff of the Office of Commissioner of Higher Education, I salute you today with congratulations and with a commitment on our part to work closely with you to cooperate in every possible way to make your job a successful one, and I'm sure it will be. Thank you.
Thank you. President Carnahan, Mrs. Carnahan, Governor, distinguished guests, faculty, and friends of Utah Technical College. I want first of all to say, as one who spent his boyhood in the United States Marines, that I appreciated that fanfare. This is indeed a very happy occasion. It's a great honor for me to have the opportunity to participate in this day, a day of joy for President Carnahan, Mrs. Carnahan, and their family. I wish I could say, without any reservation at all, that I'm happy to be here. It takes all the Christian charity I have to say that I wish that Orville were with us and not with you. Many of you have made this a happy occasion. Your friendship has been much appreciated. It'll be remembered by me for many, many years to come. Among the things I will remember of this occasion is Brian Gardner. He speaks funny. On behalf of Orville's former colleagues, presidents of the community colleges in Washington, I bring a gift from one of the presidents, the president of Grays Harbor College, who is of Polish extraction, is known in our circles as the Magnetic Pole. He has that title because he always has a story. When I told him that I was coming down here, he told me a story that I'm happy to share with you, especially after listening to Brian Gardner. And the story goes like this, that once upon a time, there was a mother mouse who gathered about her a small group of mice with one objective in mind, and that was to move the family across the street. And so she reminded them as she stood on the curb to look to the left, to look to the right, and they did that, and they moved across, and they got about halfway across the street when they looked up, and on the curb on the other side was a fierce cat poised to attack. And the mice gathered around the mother, and the mother looked around. Finally, she went, bow, wow, wow, wow! And the cat's tail went up and away, it scrambled, and the moral of the story is that it's nice to have a second language. Before relieving myself of my few comments, I want to set the record straight on several important issues. I come from Washington, and I want to make it clear in this day and age that it's the state of Washington, not Washington, D.C. Washington, D.C. is also a state, albeit a state of mind. About the state of mind in Washington, I wish to acknowledge that Utah is centrally involved in the shaping of education for the nation through the efforts of Ted Bell and David Gardner. The Washington with which I am familiar is a state populated by people who cling to a populist view of government and education. We do not aspire to bring Harvard westward. We do not believe, or I beg your pardon, we do believe strongly that every person, regardless of his station in life, should be guaranteed equality of opportunity, especially educational opportunity. As a consequence, we stand first in the nation in the access our students have to higher education in the public sector. Well, we are very proud of the fact that 4.2% of our population is currently enrolled in a public institution of higher education. We are making the painful discovery that it is costly to pay for the opportunity we have so generously extended to our citizens. By way of comparison, Utah enrolls 3.9% of its population in public higher education. However, when the independent sector is factored in, Utah has a larger participation rate than Washington. You in Utah believe in higher education. But that is not our subject today. Today is a festive occasion, the inauguration of Orville D. Carnahan as a president of Utah Technical College. I understand that you have not had many presidents since 1948. As a consequence, some of you, like me, may not be entirely familiar with the process, this medieval activity we're going through under these lights that are permitting me to outrun my right guard. Let me share with you some of the rich fruits of my recent research. I utilize my trustworthy Oxford English Dictionary. The word inaugurate is a verb which entered the English language in 1606. The basic word is augurate, also a verb. Augurate means to perform the duties of augur. That's a nice thing about dictionary, it really helps. But be patient, here we're making progress. Augur joined the English language in 1549. Its roots are Latin. Now for the definition. The definition makes it very clear why we are here and why we are honoring Orville Carnahan. An augur in Roman history was a religious official who interpreted omens derived from the flight, singing, and feeding of birds and advised upon the course of public business in accordance with the omens. Now, Orville is religious, and he can, at moments, be official, or at least in the process today of becoming official. But who are the birds whose flight, singing, and feeding generate these omens? In the state of Washington, they could be the faculty, the trustees, or the legislators. I cannot venture a guess for Utah. The part I like is that based on the omens from the birds, the augur formulated advice upon the course of public business. The advice is probably for the birds. However, for this occasion, to inaugurate means to admit or induct to an office or dignity by a formal ceremony. This is truly our business today. I have known and worked with Orville Carnahan for many years. His virtues are too numerous to list, for they would utilize fully my allotted time. His vices have two virtues. First, they are few. And secondly, they are boring. Therefore, I will share a few observations about Orville Carnahan, the educator. What kind of president is he likely to make? Fortunately, he does not need to fill that waggish definition of a college president offered some years ago by A. Whitney Griswold. Griswold facetiously assigned to the president three duties: to provide one, football for the alumni; two, parking for the faculty; and three, sex for the undergraduates. Except for number two, parking for the faculty, the others are clearly beyond Dr. Carnahan's capabilities. A president is a leader, and a leader is a risk taker. In our complex world, a leader needs to have a vision. In this instant, I mean a vision for this institution for the years ahead, especially for this trying decade. A leader needs to have the courage to translate his vision into a reality. That famous philosopher, whom you all know, Charlie Brown, observed from the comic strips that there's no heavier burden than a great potential. This decade will be difficult, but amid the myriad of difficulties, there is potential. I am convinced beyond any doubt that Orville Carnahan is equal to the challenge. He is brainy, low-key, collegial, optimistic, and one thing more, he will positively enjoy complexity and constant change, which is sure to be his lot. We'll have no shortage of complexity and change. Few people really realize that the election of 1980 was not just another election among our quadrennial presidential plebiscites. It is a major political discontinuity. No one, certainly not I, can foretell what the future will be like. But I do know that many convictions we have held for years are being questioned now. Many of the traditional faiths of higher education are being tested and will be tested and should be tested. One of the president's primary responsibilities will be to sustain hope. We must remember every day that what moves people to action is more hope than fear, not just a vision of how bad things might become, but a vision of how things might be improved. The future will require our rethinking many of our historic and traditional assumptions. I remember, and there are a few out here I think are old enough to remember, George Burns and Gracie Allen radio shows, where Gracie Allen, that delightful comedian, would frequently sprinkle in the show the remarks, "The trouble with life is that it is so daily." And we have to lift ourselves above those daily things to gain a perspective in these times. The needs of citizens for our services will alter considerably. In fact, they are altering right now. And in order to grasp the magnitude of change, it is necessary to obtain some historic perspective. Higher education from 1636, when John Harvard founded his college on the banks of the Charles River, was intended at that time for the few and not for the many. If you were white, male, Protestant, well-born, and well-to-do, you had an opportunity. And the endless, relentless march of higher education has one common thread that binds it together, and that is the extension of that opportunity from the few to the many. The forces outside the academy generated the significant changes which transformed the face and mission of higher education. The first higher education institution for women in the Western world, the Troy Seminary in upstate New York, did not come from within the academy. It was necessary for Emma Willard to found in 1821 a new and separate institution. The needs of agriculture and industry forced the Congress to create, by land grants, colleges to meet the emerging needs of farmers and machinists. Traditional higher education was unfriendly to the idea. I might add parenthetically, it's a word I learned from Brian Gardner. One of the fears entertained by the people of that time who were members of the academy is that a land-grant institution devoted to helping farmers and machinists and industrialists and homemakers would subtract from the liberal arts. Today, the institution in this country, which provides the greatest number of degrees in music, is a land-grant institution. I speak of the University of Indiana. Among the other arguments used was the fear that the value of the liberal arts might be diminished. Time has demonstrated that the liberal arts flourished and that the contributions of the land-grant colleges over those years to agricultural productivity exceeded the wildest dreams of Justin Morrill in 1862, when in one of the darkest moments of the Civil War, President Abraham Lincoln affixed his signature to one of the brightest chapters in higher education. I cite these examples to prepare you for one of the conclusions reached by the Truman Commission in 1947. When a grateful Congress unanimously passed the Servicemen's Readjustment Act in 1944, one of the questions which arose was, can and should our existing system of higher education absorb the influx of students who will be seeking education beyond the high school? President Truman, on July 13, 1946, established the President's Commission on Higher Education and charged its members with the task of examining the functions of higher education in our democracy and the means by which they can be best performed. 18 months later, the commission filed its report entitled Higher Education for American Democracy. One of the problems faced by the head commission was the structure of higher education. What structure would be needed to accommodate not only the returning service personnel, but also the increasing percentages of high school graduates who were seeking post-high school education? The commission declared at that time that 49% of the high school graduates could benefit from at least 2 years of college level work. That figure, 49% name for a new two-year college located in communities throughout the nation. These new institutions were called community colleges. They were to serve the needs of students and of communities. In my own state, in 1967, the legislature adopted the Community College Act and fixed the responsibility of the colleges with these important words. The colleges were to offer an open door to every citizen, regardless of his academic experience, at a cost normally within his economic means. They were also to offer a thoroughly comprehensive educational training and service program to meet the needs of both the communities and the students served by combining with equal emphasis high standards of excellence in academic transfer courses, realistic and practical courses in occupational education, and community services of an educational, cultural, and recreational nature. There have been two results since 1967 that to me are surprising. In the first phase, there were many who believed that occupational education would suffer if these institutions became comprehensive. What has actually happened? In 1967, only 14% of our institutional effort was devoted to occupational programs. Today, 48% of the effort is occupational. The second change of significance is the role the institutions have taken in their communities. The Truman Commission report recommended that the community college seeks to become the center of learning for the entire community, with or without the restrictions that surround formal coursework in traditional institutions of higher education. By serving a growing number of students with diverse needs and by serving responsibly their communities, they have become the people's college of this century. While much has been accomplished, much remains to be done. In what we do, we need to remember that we are a nation of purpose. Historically, America is that unique nation whose political faith is summed up in one word, opportunity. History is story. Politics and the process of becoming history is a story of a handful of men and even fewer women reaching for those levers of power. But politics need dreams to lean on. Those politicians in our land who have achieved historical stature use their power to enlarge opportunity for people. We as a nation are happily devoid of heroes who won their place in history by their military conquest. We have no Alexander the Great, no Napoleon, and no Hitler. Thomas Jefferson and Abraham Lincoln have epitomized the American political hero. Jefferson is a hero of independence. He captured the spirit which was to make the invention of a nation possible when he sat in the solitude and of creative travail in Graff House in Philadelphia and penned the immortal words, "All men are created equal." It should surprise no one to observe that education was a primary passion over his long and productive life. The new nation, if it was to be a democracy, which meant if it was to come from the people, required an educated citizenry. But it took another hero to enlarge and extend Jefferson's lofty dreams. Lincoln was a victorious war president, but his monuments are in the extension of opportunity. Those achievements were prodigious. Lincoln, more than any other president, innately recognized the faith the American people have placed in opportunity. He used his control of the levers of power to enlarge opportunity. Here are but a few of his actions which come to mind. He freed the slaves, thereby permitting a whole race to entertain hope for opportunity. He opened the lands of the frontier to moneyless homesteaders who, like those who had crossed an ocean to find opportunity, could go west with hope. He endowed colleges and provided them with land grants, thereby extending opportunity for learning to whole new segments of youths. It is from this strong national faith and opportunity that our colleges have sprung, as long as we continue to remember that opportunity is essential to our national faith and use our energies to provide opportunity not for the few only, but for the many, we will not only survive, but we will flourish. The people in this nation know in their blood that somehow schools and education are still linked to jobs, economic growth, and higher productivity in a decent public order. Utah Technical College must continue to demonstrate that it can fulfill the needs students bring with them. And under the leadership of Orville Carnahan, and with your support, you will fulfill your mission with distinction. Thank you very much for permitting me this opportunity to share with you this happy and memorable occasion. Thank you.
This is a joyous occasion. The State Board of Birds that I represent has as its most important function that of selecting the most outstanding leadership that we can obtain to govern and administer the 9 universities and colleges in the state. And Orville Carnahan is Exhibit A that we think we've done a good job. We are very pleased to participate in the inaugural today, but unfortunately, Orville, it falls our lot to tell you what our expectations are for your service and to give you what the program calls a charge. I read where previous regents have said that they do hope you get a charge out of it. We recognize your significant administrative and leadership abilities. President Carnahan, you've successfully served as the president of 3 institutions in Iowa, Washington, and Utah prior to your appointment here. But we would like you to consider the following counsel as a charge for your administration at the Technical College in Salt Lake. First, we charge you to provide curricular options, instruction, and a teaching counseling strategy that emphasizes the centrality of the student in all that you do at this institution. Today's students are sophisticated, demanding educational consumers, and education has to be designed with them in mind. Education must have tangible results. It must provide the opportunity for thorough and adequate preparation for work and careers. But since work and careers change rapidly in today's economy, students must also be prepared for successful careers in the world of living itself. And we trust that you will seek first to develop educative people who love to learn, who can and will learn to adjust and adapt throughout their lives, and who may want to return to this or other institutions for periodic updating of knowledge and skills to maintain competence in a changing world. To this end, Orville, we charge you to reach out to increase opportunities for lifelong learning and serve the community in those locations, times, and settings that will meet the need of a growing number of adults and part-time students that are seeking the benefit of higher education. We challenge you to work with your faculty to more fully integrate practical vocational education and also general liberal education at the college. We exhort you to heed the advice of the renowned educator Alfred North Whitehead, who said in 1929, "The antithesis between a technical and a liberal education is fallacious. There can be no adequate technical education which is not liberal, and no liberal education which is not technical. That is, no education which does not impart both technique and intellectual vision. In simpler language, education should turn out the pupil with something he knows well and something he can do well. This intimate union of practice and theory aids both." So to be fully effective in meeting the charge for educational integration, you should continue to work effectively with the Utah system of higher education and to cooperate with other institutions with different missions and roles, and blur the distinction between vocationally and academically trained. It is becoming blurred already with respect to social status, pay, benefits, and even job titles, and many liberal arts students are seeking career experience and occupational training, while vocational students are seeking a variety of liberal arts learning opportunities. We charge you to work closely with the state leaders of industry and business and government in planning and developing a curricula that reflect the manpower needs that the governor addressed as we move into the 90s. As we meet the needs of the Utah economy, as we serve the students by preparing them for employment in fields where they can earn a livelihood and enjoy the benefits of meaningful work in the years ahead. Business and labor leaders, Orville, should be included in your planning and on your advisory committees to make your programs and offerings relevant. Finally, you're charged to be responsible and prudent in the managing of scarce resources for higher education. While you are appointed to be a strong advocate and a voice for vocational education in this state, you must do so with a full awareness of the many other needs and pressures that are brought to bear upon the total system of higher education. And as regents, we pledge to support you. We have full confidence in you and your leadership abilities. But there is a limit to which state dollars can be stretched in serving all of the myriad needs and requests before us. We therefore strongly urge that you develop institutional priorities, that you only offer those programs that can be provided with excellence and quality. This college should lead out, and under your able direction, we are confident that it will ensure that the students and the broader Utah community are served with excellence in vocational technical education. If your commitment to excellence is undimmed, if your objectives and goals are clear and are revised regularly with broad faculty, student, and industrial input so as to be based solidly on community and individual needs, and if you and your faculty and staff remain dedicated to the high purposes for which this college was established, those being to promote and advance knowledge, to educate and train students, and to serve the state and community in which you're located, then the morale at this institution will remain high, and you will achieve much success and great personal satisfaction in your presidency. President Carnahan, this is our charge and our warm desire and best wishes for you. And on behalf of the Utah State Board of Regents, we offer sincere congratulations on your appointment as president of the Utah Technical College at Salt Lake. And on this inaugural day, we are presenting you with a symbol of your investiture of all the power and authority that we can give you in governing and administering this institution, and we'd like to do so now. Congratulations.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Chairman Gardner, Chairman Prowse, special guests, family, staff, students, and friends of Utah Technical College at Salt Lake. I'm happy for this occasion to speak to you in my inaugural address as the new president of Utah Technical College at Salt Lake. I'm pleased for your attendance here, and I'm especially pleased that my wife, Colleen, and my children, and all the rest of my family that are able to be here, were able to be here for this occasion. I have strong feelings about this position. I feel that it is exactly right for me at this time in my professional career. Time will not permit expression of all of the reasons why I feel that way. But let me touch on a few subjects that I consider of major importance at this point in time for this college, for the Salt Lake Valley, for the state of Utah, and for the nation in relation to the kind of college education that this college should be providing. Each college and university in Utah and throughout the United States should have a clearly defined philosophy and a set of goals to accomplish that philosophy. From among those goals, one should be selected and clearly identified as the college's first priority. Utah Technical College at Salt Lake is a two-year college, a technical college, with full intentions of continuing to have vocational and technical education as its major emphasis. The reason for having a technical college like Utah Technical College at Salt Lake is that somewhere in the scheme of things, there needs to be an institution whose first priority is career preparation. However, the technical college should never lose sight of the responsibility to then encourage an education for personal growth and for personal knowledge. The importance of the liberal education degree should not be diminished or downgraded just because it is not the first priority of this technical college. As Utah Technical College at Salt Lake works to fill its role as a technical college, it must broaden the scope of its vocational and technical programs to address all vocational and technical needs in the Salt Lake Valley. As we consider the possibility of broadening and expanding the college's role in vocational and technical education, as we choose new programs and new classes, we must coordinate with and avoid unnecessary duplication of classes at the university and elsewhere, including the public schools. We regularly hear the statistics that 70 or 80% of available jobs require less than a bachelor's degree of preparation, with some of them requiring less than even 1 year of post-high school education. That does not diminish the role of this technical college, but rather broadens it. Our role is to meet career preparation needs from 2 days to 2 years in duration. We will be a major community educational resource only if we address to all of the educational needs of our students and of business and industry within those parameters. We should be stressing the value of the work ethic, not just its economic value, but its value in helping achieve personal satisfaction. We should assist our students in learning the pleasure of working with their hands to gain the sense of accomplishment that comes with acquiring such a personal skill. In addition to concern for the interests of our students, we are also charged with a concern for the present and future needs of Utah's business and industry. as they relate to vocational skills and technical education. The college should be directly involved in meeting the education and training needs of new business and industry also. It is better to educate our own unskilled labor than to have new business and industry import its skilled labor from outside the state. The technical college should be a part of the community, not apart from it. The National Committee for Economic Development says that during the 1980s, there will be an even greater change in the demographics of the workforce, with a continued shift from manual to technical employment. Utah, for example, has increased its non-agricultural employment since 1970 at a rate twice the national average. The 1980 Utah Facts Book showed a reserve pool of 80,000 people and then showed a growth in the labor force for that year of 30,000 people. If part of that 30,000 is coming from out of state, we need to evaluate the reasons. The emphasis on retraining, especially upgrading, will continue to increase because of continued changes in technology, which will demand it. There will be a greater mix of work and college, thus increasing the percentage of part-time students. And our enrollment this fall reflects that very clearly here at the college. We must be willing to change our approach to education when such changes are needed. There are some new emerging approaches to education that we must be aware of. As an example, the segment of higher education called continuing education or community service is changing most significantly and most rapidly. The purpose of continuing education is to take the college courses to the community at a time and a place to better fit people's schedules. This will increase the number of classes taught evenings and weekends. It will change the location of many classes from on campus to a variety of off-campus locations. The newest approach in continuing education is taking the classes directly to a particular business or industry, new and existing, and designing it for specific needs of that business or industry. Those programs here at the college at the present time are almost totally self-supporting. Whatever our role and whatever our goals, we must keep uppermost the need to continue providing quality education in all of our programs. To do so, we must constantly evaluate our results. A very high percentage of all students coming to the technical college desiring further education are undecided as to what they should enroll in. Perhaps as many as 80% of our students are undecided. This increases tremendously the need for a good counseling and testing program at the college. In addition to advising students in specific educational programs, the college has a responsibility to provide good general career counseling, good occupational counseling, and I make a distinction, and all of the related educational counseling. To maintain the quality of the programs within the tight financial constraints that now exist and which will undoubtedly continue into the future, we must make some hard decisions. Sometimes it is far better to limit the number of programs and the number of students being enrolled rather than reduce finances to all existing programs and face the risk of reducing the quality of education in general. So we must plan and plan carefully. Although a college is not a business in the sense of a profit-making business or industry, it can and should be operated in a business-like way. As we get wound up in the never-ending matters and concerns of successfully operating this college, we must never lose sight of the fact that we are not dealing with widgets on an assembly line. We're working with people, real live people, whether students, faculty, staff, and no action or decision should be dehumanizing in any way to any of them. Peter Drucker has said that the future of a two-year college, such as this technical college, will depend on how well we respond to such things as aging adults, re-entering high school dropouts, normally progressing high school graduates, career changers, re-entry women, job obsolescence, new occupational trends, improved education for the handicapped, dramatic need for basic skills, increased propensity for life enrichment and coping programs, and the innate self-generating nature of learning. He further says that the two-year college will make its future contribution as a central element of the infrastructure of the knowledge society. The future of this technical college rests with those it serves and those who serve its mission. The pressure on higher education during the 80s and probably into the 90s will continue to be a demand for accountability and for performance. Although college degrees will continue to be of major importance to most employers, much greater pressure will exist for determining the specific capabilities that come with those degrees. Some businesses are even now considering entrance examinations for potential employees to test the viability of those degrees. Demand for education is growing up, not down. What is going down and rapidly is the demand for traditional education from traditional schools. There is an increasing number of businesses requesting and even demanding that they be accredited to offer their own degrees. We must break the attitude that everyone should be given their education in the same way within the same structural process. Another cogent statement of Peter Drucker is that economics, student needs, and new understanding are bound to break the traditional educational monopoly. In my opinion, no other matter will be as important or have as much impact on the world in the coming decades as education, or the lack thereof, neither political, economic, or social welfare forces. Political, social, and economic reactions will merely be secondary to the degree and quality of education in existence. Clark Kerr, in about 1967, when he was president of the University of California at Berkeley, gave a quote from historian H.G. Wells, wherein he said, "The future of civilization is a race between education and chaos, or education and catastrophe." And it still is. Among other things, this technical college exists to help education win that race. How well career preparation and liberal education are integrated within higher education may well be the major factor in determining the future successes of higher education in Utah, in the nation, and in the world. Now, the reason for an inaugural ceremony such as this is the determination that a college president should be given a clear and specific charge as to what his role and responsibilities are. I feel like I've received that. A college president should first and last be a good leader. Equally important, he or she must be a good manager, plus have the ability and inclination to wear all of the other hats inherent in the job and do so successfully. T.H. Bell once said to me, "One thing we need in a college president is a leader who will have the courage and character to tell us what we need to hear, no matter how much we don't want to hear it." It is my intention and my commitment to you here and now that I will strive to be the kind of a college president Utah Technical College at Salt Lake needs to lead it and guide it in providing those educational needs that it exists to provide. Thank you.
Don't be concerned, I don't intend to give a talk. I did one thing, however. President Carnahan, you've received statements of support from various groups and a charge, but I would like, with your permission, to express to you also the loving support of all of us here. We want you to know that we wish you well. Mrs. Carnahan, do you have anything you'd like to say?
Let us pray. O God, our Father, creator of the universe and source of all that is good, we praise you and thank you for the gifts of this day. In word and song, and in the pageantry of drama, we have tried this day to express our dreams and aspirations and our dedication to the cause of truth and human betterment. Now, as we go forth from here to our separate and unique roles in the pageantry of life itself, we pray your special blessings upon Dr. Carnahan and his associates. We pray you give new dimensions to their dreams, a new dedication in their pursuit of truth, and a new and deeper insight into the meaning of human dignity. Grant them to a growing awareness and a sensitivity to better perceive the needs of those who come as students, and the power and the wisdom to stimulate their minds and hearts so that these too might find the vision and the dedication to serve others with their gifts. Grant to each of us, as we go forth from this moment in history, a new dimension of understanding that this can be a better world for our having lived in it, if we can only remember to share our gifts with others. All this we ask in confidence this day of you, our Creator and our Judge. Amen.
Ladies and gentlemen, we invite you now to stand as the President's party retires from the auditorium, led by President and Mrs. Carnahan. Following the platform guests, the delegates will retire, and then the faculty and staff. Thank you. Will you please arise? Ladies and gentlemen, as the academic procession recesses now, may we just remind you of the reception for the President in the North Cafeteria in about 20 minutes, and invite you, if you like to be there, to walk over to the College Center.